again, and welcome to another episode of BitNote. We'll be playing some great video game music, so stay tuned and enjoy the show. All right. So to start things off, I'll be playing music this show from a Sonic game and also an indie hit, Gone Home, a very interesting exploration atmospheric game, which I'll bring you later. But for now, let's start off with Sonic. And one thing about Sonic the Hedgehog is that the music, I mean, with fair exception, but the music stays very strong throughout the entire series, regardless of how bad the games become. But have a listen to this. That was the main theme, aka Wonder World, from Sonic Lost World by Sega. And the composition was by Tomoya Ohtani. And I believe I've played some of his music previously on this show. He did some music for Choo Choo Rocket and a few other Sonic games. So essentially, Sonic Lost World is the most recent Sonic game recently released. Unless, of course, you've listened to this as a podcast many months or even years from now and suddenly say, oh no, wait a sec, there's been more Sonic games since then. And yes, well, okay, at the time of recording anyway, and at the time of initial broadcast, and it counts. So Sonic Lost World, basically you're finding yourself in a weird, strange kind of planet thing that's made up of hexagonal shapes. And despite the fact that it's in a planet, it seems to be floating above in the sky above another planet. So right at this stage, you know that you don't follow Sonic the Hedgehog because you're trying to get practical and useful geographical knowledge and stuff. Basically, Eggman is, or Robotnik, I think he's back to Eggman, I lose track. He's basically the bad evil scientist, is kidnapping animals, turning them into robots, and also using this great big machine to suck life force out of planets and stuff. So generally doing bad things, and you as Sonic the Hedgehog have to attack him. And then of course there's these things called the Deadly Six, which do some silly stuff and bloody, bloody, bloody. They're like six extra protagonists, and each one encompasses a stereotype that you don't really care about. But Sonic Lost World is bright and colorful. It has got a fantastic soundtrack that spans a lot of different genres. You heard that was the main theme, which, as you can listen to, is really nice and vibrant and energetic. And there's a lot of, and it knows how to change it and switch around. And I especially like the music because it can keep me calm and relaxed, even if I'm finding myself constantly losing lives by running into things and dying throughout the entire game. A lot of people have compared Sonic Lost World to Super Mario Galaxy, but I don't, largely because I haven't actually played Super Mario Galaxy, which I probably should one of these days, largely so that I can one day find out exactly how much Sonic's World compares to Mario Lost Galaxy. But in the end, it doesn't matter, because, I mean, I enjoyed the game, even if it had some parts, and you could just... While it is interesting looking for the taxonomy in game, in the end, you take a game as it is, regardless of inspiration. Besides, knowing how inconsistent Sonic the Hedgehog is, I'm assuring that the very next Sonic game will be very little like Sonic Mario Lost Galaxy, so there's that. I suppose at this point I should be doing a technical breakdown of the actual gameplay of Sonic Lost World. It's a very fine and just to say, ooh, bright colours and ooh, great music and everything, but actually trying to understand exactly what the gameplay is, what you're doing from moment to moment, that's a whole question in and of itself. And largely what happens is that you're moving this blue Sonic the Hedgehog character and jumping across all these platforms that are moving, usually in 3D, but every so often it goes back and you have a side angle view and it's like classic games again, and then it transitions and you're back in 3D and stuff. And there's also some weird gravity stuff where you go around in a circle and then people say they ripped that off in Mario Galaxy, and then other people say, no, wait a sec, the whole idea of having shifting gravity in like planets was actually in Sonic Adventure 2, so Sonic actually came up with it first, so in which case Mario ripped off Sonic and then Sonic ripped off Mario or something. I don't know. It's really fascinating about how all these games just take inspiration from other things. It's got to be one of the most it's an industry that does that a lot, because you're dealing with huge technical challenges and stuff. But so essentially you're just trying to manipulate this blue hedgehog around this rather threatening environment, trying not to die along the way. And most times you'll be unsuccessful, but if you keep at it, you'll be less successful. And it's especially since a recent patch actually made sure that when you got a game over, you got more extra lives, so you could dive right back into the action. And there's some, like I said, nice parts, nice sections, and some weird wisp power-ups, which is a whole different scenario in and of itself. And I think I'm just going to move on to another track from the game now. It's, like I said, it's a fun game, only available on the Wii U at the moment and the 3DS, because Sega did this whole, you know, Nintendo-only deal with Sonic recently. So I guess the next game will be on this Nintendo console too. Maybe that's why they made it a bit like Mario Galaxy, but screw that comparison. I shouldn't keep comparing it to a game that I haven't played. What I will say, though, is the music is great as always, as I said. It's by Tomoya Otani, and there's another track on the soundtrack is available online on iTunes and Amazon, although I should warn you, when I bought it from Amazon, it said only available in the UK or in the US, not available in Ireland, which completely pissed me off. And when I try to go to Amazon.ie, you always go to Amazon.co.uk, which is a UK site, which you can't buy MP3s from. And yes, this is certainly a first world problem and really, really frustrating. And I just like to rant a bit about how the music industry, despite desperately having a fight against piracy, seems to make it increasingly hard to actually buy the music legitimately. But I really shouldn't drag this conversation down to that level. We're talking about bright and colourful video games, so that's what the theme that we should continue on. In order to mellow myself out, I will be playing a track called Sea Bottom Seek, also by, as I said, the composer Tomoyo Atanti, from Coast Zone Act 3 from Sonic Lost World. Now, I found this music nice, calming and relaxing, which was actually a very cool and calming salve to the multiple times I kept dying very brutally and getting frustrated. So I think that just to calm my feelings towards constant death in video games and to the music and to the current antiquated music industry, I think that this is precisely the song that shall calm us down and get us really in the frame of mind for the next section of the show, where I talk about Gone Home. So this is Sea Bottom Seek from Sonic Lost World by Sega. Have a listen, and I hope you enjoy. We'll be right back. that was probably the most beautiful music you had ever listened to while skating along on a rail in an underwater glass tube. So, enough of Sonic Last World, on to Gone Home, which was developed by the Fulbright Company. Gone Home is a game with many different aspects to it. Where do I even start? Well, why don't I start by playing some music from it? That sound like a good idea to anyone else? Yeah, I thought so. Have a listen. And that was At the New House / First Day of School by Chris Remo from Gone Home by the Fulbright Company. Chris Remo has done music from a couple of other games, such as 30 Flights of Loathing, which I will play one day. But as you can hear from the title, it seems rather than it's not just a fantastic escapist thing, you know, first day at school is kind of almost a mundane topic for a game. And I think mundane is actually one of the things that could be applied to this game as a compliment. Essentially, you are arriving home. You're a sister who's been like traveling the world, and you're arriving home. And when you get home, you find out that the house is completely deserted and empty. This kind of creeps you out. You have a note on the front door from your sister saying that she can't explain what happened, and please don't, you know, go rooting around the house to try to find out what happened. If you know anything about video games, you know that when a sign explicitly tells you to not do a specific action, then that's exactly what you should do. More normally, it applies to warning signs rather than notes from your fictional sister, but in this case it does, and you know what you have to do? You have to root around the house to find out what the heck is going on. And that's what you do. You go from room to room, you pick up books, you can pick up items, you rotate them around, you look at them, you open drawers, you listen to answering recording messages, you find scraps of paper left away, you examine them, you see notes, everything. You see, you've been away from your family for about a whole year. And what's more is that this game is set in the mid-90s, which means that effectively, all you've really been able to do is send them postcards back, and assumingly you should have still been able to phone them. But the idea is you've been completely disconnected to what's going on. It's not even the house you remember since they've moved since you went away. But essentially, you're trying to explore the house. You pick up a lot of, you go into, for some reason the house feels very creepy, there's an atmosphere, you wonder if there's something else extra going on there, and you see a lot of like VHS cassette tapes and like, you know, old magazines, because of course, you know, this is set in the 90s and there's, you know, posters and everything. And the more you try to get items together, the more you piece together what goes on. Strangely enough, it seems more focused, well, not too strangely once you figure it out, but the game seems very focused on what the sister was up to, you know, your sister, because you've got a sister and two parents. And when you pick up items, you get extracts from the sister's diary that you learn about her story. Now, the game seems to be kind of about her story and the parents, which is kind of weird, because if I came home and suddenly found my house abandoned and my siblings' parents weren't there, I'd be kind of more worried about why my parents weren't there rather than my siblings. Because, you know, for all we know, that she started joining this reggae punk rock group or something and is now touring the world, just didn't tell us about it. But the parents are kind of meant to be the one that are meant to be protective of their children at all costs. So if they're not turning up, you're kind of a little worried about what the heck is going on. Or at least, why didn't they give you slightly more explicit things about what's going on? That's a whole other story. But needless to say, you find it out as you root through the large house, go through corridors, try to find, you know, you deal with a few locked things so you unlock it a lot. A lot of people have said, this is so new. this is so exciting, you know, most of the time in games you're shooting and everything, and to, you know, or shooting or dealing with fantastical scenarios, and then you're doing this, which is so new to be seeing something so mundane. But to those people I say, no. Games have been doing this for a long, long time. You had text adventures, you had Myst as the classic example. There are countless games where you go around an environment trying to find clues, learn about what happened, and usually they're more progress-based. Usually it's more about finding items to help you progress and solve puzzles. This game has a little less of that and more emphasis on actually picking up items about from your environment and drawing a picture of what actually happened. And sometimes, like I said, there's the diary pages, which I think help, but sometimes I kind of wanted to figure out what's going on. Yes, it's fun and it's interesting, but there's a little more to the story, and I'm going to spoil a little bit more of it right after I play this next section of music from the game. And that was Life Moves On, also by Chris Remo. I think it's kind of a moving on track. So a lot of these pieces of music play when you pick up when you hear your sister narrate part of his diary. And this is kind of what this is about. Now, I'm going to spoil the story slightly, but only because if I don't spoil it, you'll miss a lot of what the story is actually about. So like I said, the parents have their own story, and there's some interesting stuff if you can work it out and get all the details. But the sister's one is kind of interesting. Basically, you hear she's moved in, she's getting with her friends, you read all this in the diary, and you pick up a few things. And then suddenly she says that there's this girl that she, you know, really, really likes. And at that stage, you're going, ooh, there's a girl you really like? Are you in love with her? And it turns out that yes, she is. She's a lesbian and she is in love with the girl in her class. So basically the story kind of follows that. So the story progresses effectively like this, and you learn a little bit how the interaction and a few things about how the sister is dealing with the previous life. And that's kind of what it is. So in a way, it's kind of a coming of age story about learning how your sister deals with this. I mean, and this how she reacts to this new girl in her class and what sort of connection they end up forming in their interactions. So if you're interested in that sort of stuff, it's about on par with as you're doing in the game, reading a teenager's diary and all her thoughts and feelings. So if that sounds a little off-putting to you just because you're dealing with you're worried about all the different emotions and her going into a bit descriptive, don't worry about it. There's nothing graphic or anything. I mean, sheesh, it's, you know, the game is taste. It's talking about someone's emotions. And that's kind of what this is, because look, let's put the items together here. It's set in the 90s. It's got a nostalgic appeal with all these retro, you know, VHS movie tapes and all the retro devices. And at one stage, you see a father's review of something of like something that will be an antique now, but it was cutting edge hi-fi technology back then. And you start to realize, you know, this is a personal experience about some people's about the creators of this game coming up with their fictionalized account of true experiences that they had when they were growing up in the early 90s. And I mean, it's true, because I actually checked up some articles online, and I actually found a game developer who actually played the game and said, you know, I totally relate to this. There's so many elements in the story that, you know, affected me back then, just about coming to terms with it. And well, not really coming to terms, because the girl is like already kind of knows. I didn't want to spoil that part. But the point is about the relationship, how they deal with it, the connections they form, and of course about the music, which I'll get onto in just a second. Now, that's kind of one of the stories let down. If you kind of read these sort of like stories before about a person finding themselves and blah de blah and everything, some of it can feel a bit cliche, but everyone's raving about the story and they're not quite focusing on how that it's not actually very original. But I think the whole point is that while this story is incredibly cliche, I mean, I've heard people online even say, give out to people for using this cliche in other works, but I figure even though it's completely done a lot in books and probably in graphic novels and movies, I think this is the first time I've ever seen it done in an actual video game. So, you know, it counts, I guess. Hooray, you've actually finally taken a cliche genre, but one that can be very meaningful for when in the right place, and taken it to video games. Now, also, I don't want to demean it by saying it's cliche. I mean, to be honest, the first time you read a story like this, it can actually be really inspiring. It can actually be life-altering. You see the world in a different way. You suddenly understand that through the confusion and wondering of teenage years, you're suddenly finally getting some direction, some life, and where you're going and what you want to do and stuff. And you, even if you're not into that, you suddenly read this and can get understand someone else's world. You know, that's a lot of what it's about, the girl finding herself. And I think it's great in that respect. Okay, on to the music part, which I really didn't leave enough time for. Essentially, throughout the game, you find these... You see, she does a lot more stuff than just is lesbian. It's also a lot about actual what lesbians did in the early 90s, and that was make these zines and listen to a lot of Riot Girl band. Now, Riot Girl is a feminist punk movement that was like in Washington and Oregon in the 1990s. It's kind of like the third wave of feminism in America. The first wave was actually getting the right to vote. The second wave was in the 60s, saying, you know, we need more protections. Third wave was more about, you know, protecting other minorities and stuff. But essentially, there's a lot of music from Heavens to Betsy and the Bratmobile. And I had no idea who these bands were, but it turns out these were very, very meaningful to the people who were growing up at that time, because it was punk. It was showing, you know, women in different, you know, punk music dealt with women issues, and it really related to teens at the time, and it just meant a lot to them. So it obviously meant a lot to the creators of the game. It clearly means a lot to the protagonists in the game. They've given it, and at various points in the game, you can pick up these cassette tapes, put them in players, play the music, and give the game its own background music. So I will play, on that note, I will play some special by Bratmobile, and I think that's and I'll leave the show on that. A Riot Girl genre of music to end our show about video game. So this has been David Collins with BitNote. I leave you with some special by Bratmobile. Thank you for listening.